Turn your Bibles with me this afternoon, please, to Revelation chapter 1. Back to Revelation today. I'm returning today to our series of studies going through the book of Revelation. And again, this will not be an exhaustive study through the book, not through the entire book, as there are already many passages and a few whole chapters in the book that we've already covered more than once and somewhat depth. In prior messages, I'm not going to spend much time on, except to make reference of to those prior messages that you can hear online. The purpose for this series of messages is not to focus on last day's events, but instead to study the person and the power and the holiness and the majesty of our wonderful Lord and Savior, the Lord Jesus. For us to get a better understanding of who Jesus is and of what he expects from us, and thereby to help us all to walk more closely with him. Many professing Christians have believed in a Jesus that's either of their own imagination or someone else's. I'd say the overwhelming majority of Christians today, those who call themselves Christian, imagine a Jesus who winks at their sin and who condones mediocrity and compromise in the Christian life. We see loud and clear in this book of Revelation that the real Jesus has very high standards of holiness for his saints, and that he neither winks at sin nor condones compromise in the Christian life. On the other hand, some cult groups promote an image of a Jesus who is less or a lesser being or an inferior deity to God the Father. But John reveals to us the real Jesus as he revealed himself to John. We're in Revelation chapter 1, verse 1. The revelation of Jesus Christ, which God gave unto him, to show unto his servants things which must shortly come to pass. And he sent and signified it by his angel unto his servant John, who bare record of the word of God and of the testimony of Jesus Christ and of all things that he saw. Keep a marker here in Revelation 1 and turn over to open up John chapter 19. John 19. I want to add a note here up front about John's authorship of the Revelation, which I think also will help us understand the inspiration and authority of the book. Christian historians tell us that John outlived all the other apostles. Last time I mentioned Irenaeus, an early Christian writer, wrote in his well-known volume titled Against Heresies, that John was given the revelation in the latter half of Emperor Domitian's reign, which places the writing there somewhere between 90 to 92 AD, whereas Paul was martyred in Rome by Nero about 25 years before that, in the late 60s AD. The revelation was written from Ephesus, probably late in John's life, probably before his exile to Patmos, but possibly afterwards when he returned from his exile. In the 19th chapter of John's Gospel, we read that the following took place as the Lord Jesus hung on the cross there, preparing to die. Beginning in verse 25, now there stood by the cross of Jesus his mother and his mother's sister, Mary the wife of Cleophas and Mary Magdalene. When Jesus therefore saw his mother and the disciple standing by, whom he loved, which we know throughout the Gospel of John is John himself, he saith unto his mother, Woman, behold thy son. Then saith he to the disciple, Behold thy mother. And from that hour, that disciple took her unto his own home. That's an event that we don't read of in the other Gospels. It was John who sat next to Jesus, remember, at the Lord's Supper, at the Last Supper there. We see here that John did, in fact, actually have a special relationship to the Lord Jesus, who apparently trusted John even more than his own half-brothers, James and Jude, to take care of Mary. Interesting there, thought there. Apparently, John owned property and a home, as we read here, took her into his own home. And also as his father Zebedee was a man of means, who we know had hired servants in a fishing business in Galilee. We read also in Matthew 27 and Mark 15 that John's mother, Salome, was one of the women that ministered to Jesus out of their abundance, and so John's family had some wealth. From Paul's statement, I believe, in 1 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 5, I do believe it's safe to presume that John was probably also married, and so it was appropriate for the Lord Jesus to commit his mother into John's care, where Christian historians say that she remained for about 15 years after the resurrection of Jesus until she died. And then sometime after that, John moved to Ephesus, prior to Jerusalem's destruction by Rome in AD 70. Turn over to John 21. So it does appear that John did have this special sort of relationship with the Lord Jesus, above the other apostles, apparently, which we see more evidence here of John 21. When, after Christ's resurrection, the Lord Jesus appeared to his disciples as they were fishing near the shore there of Lake Galilee. They'd been fishing all night and cast nothing. And then they saw Jesus standing on the shore, but they didn't know it was him. So we're reading John 21, verse 5. Then Jesus saith unto them from the shore, Children, have ye any meat? They answered him, No. And then just as he had done about 3.5 years before that, we read in verse 6 that Jesus said unto them, Cast the net on the right side of the ship, and ye shall find. And they cast therefore, and now they were not able to draw it, for the multitude of fishes. They couldn't get the nets up. And verse 7, Therefore that disciple whom Jesus loved, which again we know is the term John uses of himself, saith unto Peter, It is the Lord. This happened before. It is the Lord. So Peter immediately donned his fisher's coat and swam to shore while the other disciples came in their little ship. Once on shore then, the Lord Jesus asked Peter 3 times if Peter loved him, which many presume was done to restore Peter after he had denied Jesus 3 times the night he was betrayed. We read in verse 17. He saith unto him the 3rd time, Simon, son of Jonas, lovest thou me? Peter was grieved because he said unto him the 3rd time, Lovest thou me? And he said unto him, Lord, thou knowest all things. Thou knowest that I love thee. Jesus saith unto him, Feed my sheep. Verse 18, Jesus said, Verily, verily, I say unto thee, when thou wast young, thou girdest thyself, and walkest whither thou wouldest. You went where you wanted to go. But when thou shalt be old, thou shalt stretch forth thy hands, and another shall gird thee, and carry thee, whether thou wouldst not. John says, This spake he, signifying by what death he should glorify God. And we know that Peter also refers to that there, I believe, in 2 Peter. He said that the Lord Jesus made clear to him that he was going to put off this tabernacle. And when he had spoken thus, he saith unto him, Follow me. Then Peter, turning about, seeth that disciple whom Jesus loved, John, following, which also leaned on his breast at supper, and said, Lord, which is he that betrayeth thee? Peter, seeing him, saith to Jesus, Lord, what shall this man do? Jesus saith unto him, If I will that he tarry till I come, what is that to thee? Follow thou me. Then went this saying abroad among the brethren that the disciple should not die. Yet Jesus said not unto him, He shall not die, but if I will that he tarry till I come, what is that to thee? This is the disciple which testifieth of these things and wrote these things. And John says we know his testimony is true. Turn to Matthew chapter 16. This event in John 21 is again one of several occurrences that John records that the other gospel writers do not. But personally, I believe that this exchange in John 21 between Jesus and Peter sheds light on Christ's statement that was recorded by Luke in Luke chapter 9 and also here in Matthew 16, where the Lord Jesus said this in verse 27, The Son of Man shall come in the glory of his Father with his angels, and then he shall reward every man according to his works. Verse 28, Verily I say unto you, there be some standing here which shall not taste of death till they see the Son of Man coming in his kingdom. My personal belief is that here the Lord Jesus is referring specifically to John, who would not die until he saw the Lord Jesus coming in his kingdom, which he did see when he was in the isle that's called Patmos, in the Spirit, on the Lord's Day, and was told to write it down. John was the only apostle of the 12 that was not martyred and that lived to a very old age. A few years before his death, during the latter half of Domitian's reign, he was exiled to Patmos, where he was given the revelation, and from which he was then released from Patmos, returned to Ephesus, and lived there a few more years. So I see this book of Revelation actually as Christ, as a fulfillment of Christ's promise in Matthew 16:28, that there be some standing here which shall not taste of death till they see the Son of Man coming in his kingdom. In no less than 38 verses in the book of Revelation, we read where John says, I saw, and I saw, I saw. 38 times, 38 verses. Revelation 22, verse 8, we read, And I, John, saw these things and heard them. And certainly in this book, we see the Son of Man coming in His kingdom. And so John said, When I had heard and seen, and when I had heard and seen, I fell down to worship before the feet of the angel which showed me these things. I said all that to say this, that even though many things that we do read in this book, the revelation of Jesus Christ, are as yet difficult to understand or to explain, and like Daniel's prophecy, actually some of the things that are written in this book are yet sealed, actually, and kept secret until the time of the end, such as where we read in Revelation 10, verse 4, And when the seven thunders had uttered their voices, I was about to write, And I heard a voice from heaven saying unto me, Seal up those things which the seven thunders uttered, and write them not. So all that said, we do have very good reason to believe, good reason to see this book as the very word of the Lord Jesus as given directly to the Apostle John, and to see this book as wonderfully awesome, as the divinely inspired and authoritative word of God, and to live by it, and to uphold it even unto death. Back to the text, verse 3. Blessed is he that readeth, and they that hear the words of this prophecy, and keep those things which are written therein, for the time is at hand. John, to the seven churches which are in Asia, grace be unto you and peace from him which is, and which was, and which is to come, and from the seven spirits which are before his throne. I want to add in here at this point, also that these seven spirits which are before his throne, the seven spirits before the throne, are seen also in Revelation 4 and 5. Over in Revelation 4, we read in verse 5, And out of the throne proceeded lightnings and thunderings and voices. Revelation 4, 5, And there were seven lamps of fire burning before the throne, which are the seven spirits of God. We read about these seven spirits also over in chapter 5 and verse 6, where John says, And I beheld, and lo, in the midst of the throne and of the four beasts, and in the midst of the elders, stood a lamb as it had been slain, having seven horns and seven eyes, which are the seven spirits of God sent forth into all the earth. This is obviously symbolic, prophetic imagery, not to be taken literally. These seven spirits of God, picture both as seven eyes and as seven lamps of fire burning before the throne. This refers to seven specific and specially appointed angels that stand before the throne of God, and they are sent out occasionally to do his bidding. Including, these are the seven angels that sound the seven trumpets, the seven trumpet judgments in chapters 8 to 9. We read in Revelation 8, verse 1, When he had opened the seventh seal, after those first seven seal judgments are completed, the seventh seal, he opens that, there was silence in heaven about the space of half an hour. Two, and I saw the seven angels which stood before God. Seven angels which stood before God, and to them were given seven trumpets. And the seven angels which had the seven trumpets prepared themselves to sound. As mentioned a couple of weeks back in my message about the day of small things, we see these same seven angels back in Zechariah chapter 4 using very similar language. Zechariah chapter 4, verse 2, we read there, And he said unto me, What seest thou? Zechariah said, I have looked, and behold, a candlestick all of gold, with the bowl upon the top of it, and his seven lamps thereon, and seven pipes to the seven lamps, which are upon the top thereof. Down in verse 10 of Zechariah 4, that's where God says, For who hath despised the day of small things? For they shall rejoice and see the plummet in the hand of Zerubbabel. Remember, he's going to build that second temple. They shall see the plummet in the hand of Zerubbabel with those seven, meaning the seven lamps in verse 2. They are the eyes of the Lord, which run to and fro through the whole earth. So we see there again, seven lamps and the eyes of the Lord, seven eyes of the Lord. So both in Zechariah chapter 4 and Revelation chapters 1, 4, and 5, we see these seven angels described both as seven lamps of fire burning before the throne, and seven eyes, which are the seven spirits of God sent forth into all the earth. So that's what these seven spirits are. Doesn't mean that God the Father has a seven-part being. It means he has seven angels that go out and do his bidding. Back to chapter 1 then. Revelation. Back to Revelation chapter 1, where we then read in verse 4. John, the seven churches which are in Asia. Grace be unto you and peace from him which is and which was and which is to come, and from the seven spirits which are before his throne, and from Jesus Christ, who is, first, the faithful witness, secondly, the first begotten of the dead, and third, the prince of the kings of the earth. We covered those three aspects of Christ's divine character last time. Then we read, unto him that loved us and washed us from our sins in his own blood, and hath made us kings and priests unto God and his Father. In which capacity, by the way, we read in Revelation 5, verse 10, that we shall reign on the earth, the text says there, on the earth. We're going to reign on the earth with him in his kingdom. To him, then, be glory and dominion forever and ever. Amen. Verse 7, John says, behold, he cometh with clouds, and every eye shall see him, and they also which pierced him. And all the kindreds, all the families, all the races of the earth shall wail because of him. We covered this verse last time also when we saw how it refers back to Zechariah chapters 12 through 14, where we see that the revelation cannot be a prophecy of Jerusalem's destruction in AD 70, as the preterists very wrongly like to imagine. Can't be. Because this is about another day where Jerusalem is delivered, not destroyed. Even so, amen, says John at the end of verse 7. Then we read in verse 8. I am Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the ending, saith the Lord, which is, and which was, and which is to come, the Almighty. Jesus is the Alpha and Omega, we're going to see today, saith the Lord, which is, and which was, and which is to come, the Almighty. I, John, who also am your brother and companion in tribulation, and in the kingdom and patience of Jesus Christ. Again, we come to that word patience in the book of Revelation. That means the willing endurance of persecution and tribulation. That's what that word patience means in this book. In the kingdom and patience, suffering for Jesus. Here John is on the island of Patmos, banished to a prison camp, basically. I, John, who also am your brother, companion in tribulation and in the kingdom and patience of Jesus Christ, was in the isle that's called Patmos for the word of God, for preaching it, and for the testimony of Jesus Christ. Verse 10, I was in the Spirit on the Lord's day, and heard behind me a great voice as of a trumpet, saying, I am Alpha and Omega, the first and the last. What thou seest, write in a book, and send it unto the seven churches which are in Asia, unto Ephesus, and unto Smyrna, and unto Pergamos, and unto Thyatira, and unto Sardis, and unto Philadelphia, and unto Laodicea. The Lord Jesus is revealed in these verses as no less than Jehovah incarnate. One and the same El Shaddai, or God Almighty, that appeared to Abraham, and the same I Am that appeared to Moses in the burning bush. However, all the modern perversions of the Bible, the NASV, the NIV, ESV, ISV, etc., ad infinitum, they all follow the corrupted Greek text of Origen, Eusebius, Westcott, and Hort, and they delete that phrase beginning and ending in verse 8. As does, by the way, the JW's, a.k.a. the Watchtower Society's New World Translation, which then carries the perversion a step further by changing the Lord at verse 8 to Jehovah God. The JW's perverted Bible at verse 8 says, I am the Alpha and Omega, says Jehovah God, the one who is and who was and who is coming, the Almighty. Which then shows the purpose for the devil's perversion of God's word at this verse, which is to claim, as the JWs most definitely do, that the Lord Jesus is not in view at verse 8. That he's not Jehovah, he's not God Almighty. But that the words in that verse instead refer to the Father, who is Jehovah. And then, since verses 12 through 13 clearly show that the Lord Jesus must be in view at verse 11, all those same perversions of the Bible delete altogether from verse 11 that phrase, I am Alpha and Omega, the first and the last. take that out of the verse. Again, which is done in order to deny the full and complete deity of the Lord Jesus. As is often the case, however, these perversions don't follow through very well with their corruptions of God's Word. And so in this chapter, all those same perversions, Watchtower, JW version included, still show the Lord Jesus revealed in verse 17 as the first and last. They have to because the context demands it. Verse 17, when I saw him, I fell at his feet as dead. And he laid his right hand upon me, saying, Fear not, I am first and the last. I am he that liveth and was dead. And behold, I am alive forevermore. Amen. And have the keys of hell and death. I want to tell you that all of these verses refer to the Lord Jesus. We're going to see that today. We also see in the words of the Lord Jesus in chapter 2, verse 8, in his address to the church of Smyrna. Revelation 2, verse 8, And unto the angel of the church in Smyrna write, These things saith the first and the last, which was dead and is alive. And so we see in chapter 1, verse 17, and chapter 2, verse 8, that he who is called first and last is also he that died and rose again from the dead. And so the JWs and others allow that that is Jesus. So they admit Jesus is first and the last. Keep that in mind. However, they forgot, or they were ignorant of the fact, that those very words first and last also clearly identify Jesus as being the one who is eternal. One and the same as Jehovah of the Old Testament, God Almighty, whose goings forth have been from of old, from everlasting, as Isaiah says of him. The real Bible is very clear in teaching that the name Jehovah applies to Jesus every bit as much as it applies to the Father and also to the Spirit. And also that whenever Jehovah God reveals himself to man, he does so through the Son, who is Jehovah incarnate. Turn to Isaiah chapter 41. That very phrase, first and last, identifies the Lord Jesus as Jehovah of the Old Testament. Isaiah 41, verse 4. God says, Who hath wrought and done it, calling the generations from the beginning? I, the Lord. You see that word Lord in all caps. That's the translation of the Hebrew tetragrammaton, the name of Jehovah. I, the Lord, Jehovah, the first and with the last, I am he. In Isaiah 44, turn over to chapter 44, we read there, Isaiah 44, verse 6, Thus saith the Lord, again, that means Jehovah, Thus saith the Lord, the King of Israel, and his Redeemer, the Lord of hosts, that's Jehovah Sabaoth, I am the first, and I am the last, and beside me there is no God. There it is. I am first, and I am the last, and beside me there is no God. Given these clear words here in Isaiah 44, verse 6, the clear statement of this verse, I would say that it would be beyond presumptuous to being even blasphemous for the Lord Jesus to call himself the first and the last in John's revelation if he were not Jehovah, Jehovah God, Jehovah incarnate. However, to the contrary, this verse teaches that Jesus, who revealed himself to his apostle John as first and last, is in fact Jehovah God, and that beside him there is no God. Isaiah 44, verse 6 says, Beside him there is no God. Well, wait a minute. What about God the Father and God the Holy Spirit? Well, that's a great question. And this is why Bible-believing Christians must believe in the doctrine of the Trinity. Three persons united in one Godhead, whose name alone is Jehovah, the great I Am, beside whom there is no other God. We have to understand that truth. It's a great truth to understand. Verse 6, Thus saith the Lord, the King of Israel, and his Redeemer, the Lord of hosts, I am the first, and I am the last, and beside me there is no God. Verse 8, Fear ye not, neither be afraid. Have I not told thee from that time, and have declared it? Ye are even my witnesses. Jehovah's Witnesses need to read this. If they want to be Jehovah's Witnesses, they need to witness for Jesus. Ye are my witnesses. Is there a God beside me? Yea, there is no God. I know not any. Here, Jehovah, first and last, says, Beside me there is no God. And is there a God beside me? Yea, there is no God. I know not any. Well, apparently, the JW is no better than that because they have another God that they give lip service to, and that's their version of Jesus, who they say is a God, a little God, but a lesser God than Jehovah himself. John reveals to us, both in Revelation and in his gospel, that Jesus is no less than Jehovah God. We know the verses, John 1, verse 1 through 3. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. Right? The same was in the beginning with God. All things were made by Him, and without Him was nothing made, was not anything made that was made. These verses obviously plainly refer to the Lord Jesus. The context makes that truth undeniable. And so to deny Jesus' full deity and equality with the Father, as most of us know, the JWs, the Watchtower Translation, very subtly perverts the passage by the insertion of that little participle A just before the end of the verse. Their perversion at verse 1 says, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was a God. And yes, they do use a lowercase g in their perversion of the Bible, little g God, when referring to the Lord Jesus. So whenever I personally have occasion to confront a Jehovah's Witness with their damnable heresy that Jesus is not fully God, Jehovah incarnate, the first thing I typically do is ask them how many gods they believe in. They say they're, monotheistic, only believe in one God. So when they say only one God, I ask them to read their version of John 1, verse 1. What's your version say here? And then I ask them again, how many gods did you say you believe in? Then I take them to this passage here in Isaiah 44, verse 6. And tell them even their Bible says there's only one God and also that Jesus is Jehovah. Because these verses are about Jesus. The Watchtower's perversion of Isaiah 44, verse 6 is corrupted, but it still says this. This is their version. This is what Jehovah says, the King of Israel and his repurchaser. That's the word they use for redeemer. Then they say Jehovah of armies. That's Jehovah. That's the Lord of hosts. They translate that as Jehovah of armies. This is what Jehovah says, the King of Israel and his repurchaser, Jehovah of armies. I am the first and I am the last. There is no God but me. Their version plainly says that Jehovah says I am the first and I am the last. And their version of Revelation 1 verse 17 also says, he laid his right hand on me and said, do not be afraid, I am the first and the last and the living one, and I became dead, but look, I am living forever, and I have the keys of death and of the grave. So their Bible says there in verse 17 of chapter 1 that Jesus is first and the last. And here in Isaiah 44 it says Jehovah is first and last. So JW's Bible still teaches that Jesus is one and the same Jehovah of the Old Testament. But they are so horribly brainwashed, it's very, very difficult to get through to them. By that time, if I still have JW's ear, I typically try to show them one more verse, and that is from John's Gospel, which is in John chapter 8, where Jesus said, I therefore said unto you that ye shall die on your sins, for if ye believe not, Jesus said, that I am he, ye shall die in your sins. And I typically would point out that this verse is saying, Jesus saying to the Pharisees there, unless you believe that he is in fact Jehovah God, they cannot be saved. And that's true of the Jehovah's Witness. Unless they believe that Jesus is the I Am that appeared to Abraham, they cannot be saved. And so, then I go down to the closing verses here of John chapter 8, where if they disagree with that, Jesus says here in John 8 verse 56, to the Pharisees, Jesus said, your father Abraham rejoiced to see my day. He saw it and was glad. And the Jews said unto him, thou art not yet 50 years old, and hast thou seen Abraham? Verse 58, Jesus said unto them, verily, verily, I say unto you, before Abraham was, I am. Before Abraham was, I am. We read then they took up stones to cast at him, but Jesus hid himself, went out of the temple, going through the midst of them, and so passed by. Why did they want to stone him? Because they knew he was claiming to be Jehovah. That's why. John shows us plainly that Jesus claimed to be and was and is no less than Jehovah God in human flesh. And John did so more than the other gospel writers, in fact, because John is here writing 30 to 40 years after they did, and by then he was confronting heretics in the church who denied Christ's deity, along with other Gnostic heretics who denied that Jesus had come in the flesh. They were teaching that Jesus was God, but he could not have come in the flesh. So John reveals to us, as the Lord Jesus revealed himself to John, that the Lord Jesus Christ is in fact and in truth no less than Jehovah El Shaddai, God Almighty. He shows us that in this chapter and in chapter 22, and in chapter 2, verse 8, where Jesus addresses the church in Smyrna as the first and last. And you turn to Revelation chapter 2, where we also see here Jesus revealed as Jehovah. Revelation chapter 2, we read in verse 18, "And unto the church, unto the angel of the church in Thyatira, write, These things saith the Son of God, who hath his eyes like unto a flame of fire, and his feet are like fine brass. Jesus says, I know thy works and charity and service and faith, and thy patience and thy works." Says works twice there. "And the last to be more than the first." So he commends them first. But then he says, notwithstanding, verse 20, "Notwithstanding, I have a few things against thee. Because thou sufferest, you permit, you put up with that woman Jezebel, who calleth herself a prophetess, to teach and to seduce my servants to commit fornication, and to eat things sacrificed unto idols. And I gave her space to repent of her fornication, and she repented not. Jesus says, Behold, I will cast her into a bed, and them that commit adultery with her into great tribulation, except they repent of their deeds." And then look what the gentle Jesus says. "And I will kill her children with death." Very serious and somber statement. This is not exactly the gentle, harmless Jesus that winks at sin and condones compromise that many apostates preach about today. Then he says this. After he says, "I'll kill her children with death, and all the churches shall know that I am he which searcheth the reins and the hearts, and I'll give unto every one of you according to your works." Jesus says, "I am he which searcheth the reins and hearts." Notice that Jesus here is the one that will be our judge. As he said in John 5, verse 22, he said, "For the Father judgeth no man, but hath committed all judgment unto the Son." Jesus is the one who will judge us. Here he says, "I will give unto every one of you according to your works." But that's not all he says. He says, "And all the churches shall know that I am he which searcheth the reins and the hearts." Here, Jesus claims very clearly to be the omniscient, all-knowing God who knows all things, even the secret thoughts of man's hearts. Jesus knows not only what we do, but he knows the reasons that we do the things we do. That's what he means here by he who searcheth the reins and the hearts. He knows if the good works that we do are done in service to him, are being done in effect to serve him, or just as an outward show of a make-believer. In making this claim, Jesus is saying that all the churches will know that I am Jehovah of the Old Testament. Because we read in Jeremiah 17, verse 10, very similar words. "I, the Lord, I, Jehovah, search the heart, I try the reins." We read in Jeremiah 17, verse 10. "I, Jehovah, search the heart, I try the reins, even to give every man according to his ways and according to the fruit of his doings." Jesus said, all the churches will know, I'm the one. Prophesied in Jeremiah 17. Jesus says, when I judge the churches, all the churches will know that I am the same one Jeremiah wrote about. We see other similar scriptures elsewhere in the Old Testament. Jeremiah 11, verse 20. "But O Lord of hosts," there's that Jehovah Sabaoth, "Lord of hosts, that judgeth righteously, that trieth the reins and the heart." Jeremiah 11, 20. "That trieth the reins and the heart. Let me see thy vengeance on them, for unto thee have I revealed my cause." We also read in Psalm 7, verse 9. "Oh, let the wickedness of the wicked come to an end, but establish the just, for the righteous God trieth the hearts and reins." The righteous God trieth the hearts and reins. Jesus said, when I judge the churches, all the churches will know, I'm the one David wrote about, I'm the one Jeremiah wrote about, I'm Jehovah. Amen. Jesus clearly claimed to be Jehovah in this passage, just as he did also in John chapter 8, and that's why the Pharisees picked up stones to stone him right then and there. Lord Jesus is revealed in this book as Jehovah, first and last. He is revealed in this book as Jehovah, searcher of the hearts. In Revelation 22, he is also revealed both as God Almighty, turn to Revelation 22, He's revealed in Revelation 22 both as God Almighty and also as Jehovah the Shepherd. Turn to Revelation 22 and also to Isaiah 40. Revelation 22 and Isaiah 40. Jesus is revealed in this book as no less than Jehovah God, God Almighty, in the flesh. We read in Revelation 22, verse 12, Jesus says, "And behold, I come quickly." That can only be God the Son, by the way. God the Father is not coming at the second advent. "Behold, I come quickly, and my reward is with me to give every man according as his work shall be." Then we read in verse 13, "I am Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end, the first and the last." First of all, this passage in Revelation 22 confutes and dispels the modern Bible perversion's attempts to corrupt chapter 1, verse 8, because it proves, in concert with Revelation 1:17 and 2:8, that Jesus is not only first and last, but he is also Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end, which they tried to strip him of in chapter 1. And who therefore, Jesus, based upon chapter 1, verse 8, is also the Lord, which is, and which was, and which is to come, the Almighty. So if we compare these verses with chapter 1, and we see Jesus is the Lord, which is, which was, and which is to come, the Almighty, and that refutes and disproves the J.W.'s heresy at chapter 1, verse 8. Secondly, by saying in verse 12, "My reward is with me, to give every man according as his work shall be." The Lord is here also identifying himself as one and the same Jehovah that we read about in Isaiah chapter 40, verse 9, where we read, "O Zion, that bringest good tidings, get thee up into the high mountain. O Jerusalem, that bringest good tidings, lift up thy voice with strength. Lift it up, be not afraid. Say unto the cities of Judah, behold your God." Read in verse 10. "Behold, the Lord God will come with strong hand, and his arm shall rule for him. Behold, his reward is with him, and his work before him." Verse 11. "He shall feed his flock like a shepherd. He shall gather the lambs with his arm and carry them in his bosom, and shall gently lead those that are with young." Of course, we know in John 10, verse 14, the Lord Jesus said, "I am that good shepherd, and I know my sheep, and am known of mine." And so Revelation 22, 12 to 13 reveals Lord Jesus both as God Almighty, El Shaddai, the same El Shaddai that appeared to Abraham. By the way, that's the very reason he said in John's Gospel, chapter 8, "Your father Abraham rejoiced to see my day, and he saw it and was glad. And the Jews then said to him, thou art not yet 50 years old, and hast thou seen Abraham? And Jesus said unto them, verily, verily, I say unto you, before Abraham was, I am." Jesus is one and the same great I am that appeared to Moses in the burning bush. He is Jehovah of the Old Testament incarnate. Jesus is Jehovah Jireh, the Lord our provider. As we read in Genesis 22, verse 12, "And Abraham called the name of that place Jehovah Jireh, as it is said to this day, in the mount of the Lord it shall be seen. The Lord will provide." Jesus is Jehovah Sabaoth, the Lord of hosts, which is why he appeared to Joshua on the plains of Jericho with a drawn sword in his hand, remember? And he appeared there and identified himself as the captain of the host of the Lord. The captain of the host of the Lord. That is Jehovah Sabaoth. And then after Joshua fell on his face, remember, before the Lord, Jesus said to Joshua, "Loose thy shoe from off thy foot, for the place whereon thou standest is holy." Only God could say that. That had to be the Lord Jesus. There's Jehovah Sabaoth. Jesus is Jehovah Tzedek, who is the Lord our righteousness. As we read in Jeremiah chapter 23, Jeremiah 23, 5 through 6, we read, "Behold, the day is come, saith the Lord, that I will raise unto David a righteous branch." Of course, that's the Lord Jesus. "And a king shall reign and prosper." That's Jesus. "And shall execute judgment and justice in the earth." That's Jesus. "And in his days Judah shall be saved," not cast out and dispersed, "and Israel shall dwell safely. And this is his name whereby he shall be called, the Lord our righteousness." Jehovah Tzedek. Jesus is the Lord our righteousness. Which is why we read in 2 Corinthians 5, verse 21, "For he hath made him to be sin for us, who knew no sin, that we might be made the righteousness of God in Him. He is the Lord, our righteousness. Jesus is Jehovah. And the Jehovah of the Old Testament is revealed in the New Testament as the Lord Jesus Christ, where we now read in Acts chapter 4. Peter said, "Be it known unto you all, and to all the people of Israel, that by the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, whom ye crucified, whom God raised from the dead, even by him doth this man stand before you whole." Peter said, "This is the stone which was set at naught of you builders, which has become the head of the corner." And then he said, "Neither is there salvation in any other, for there is none other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved." There's no other name than the name of Jesus whereby we must be saved. Paul says in Philippians chapter 2 that God the Father hath highly exalted him and given him a name which is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow, of things in heaven and things in earth and things under the earth, and that every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. I want to ask you all today, have you made that confession that Jesus is Lord? God says one day every knee shall bow, every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. I want everyone to listen to me, all the children and everybody listen to me, please. Have you made the confession today that Jesus is Lord? Have you submitted yourself to His Lordship? In Matthew 22, verse 42, Jesus asked the Pharisees, "What think ye of Christ? Whose son is he?" In Matthew 16, verse 15, Jesus asked his disciples, "But whom say ye that I am?" He also asked that question of everyone in this room. Of all the many questions in the universe that are pondered and questioned by the mind of man, by far the most important question that faces every human being that ever lives is the question of who is this Jesus of Nazareth. So I'm going to ask that same question of everyone here. Man, woman, boy, and girl, who is Jesus to you? Who is Jesus to you? Is he someone you've heard about, you know some facts about, you know a few things about, you've heard in church? Or do you know him in a personal and real way as your Lord and your Master and your Savior? The Bible says that our sins and our rebellion against God's law separate us from him. And beyond that, they will ultimately, if not repented of, condemn us, not to annihilation or merely ceasing to exist as some falsely teach, but to an eternal hell and an eternal torment that Jesus called everlasting punishment prepared for the devil and his angels. The Bible says the wages of sin is death, and the death that God has in view is the hell that Jesus preached. The Bible says the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Jesus willingly suffered and bled and died and gave his life on the cross of Calvary 2,000 years ago to pay our penalty for sin so we wouldn't have to. So John writes in John 1 verse 11, "He came into his own and his own received him not, but as many as received him, to them gave he power, authority, to become the sons of God, even to them that believe on his name." So if you today have never repented of your rebellion and your sin against God, if you've never received the Lord Jesus as your Savior and Lord, I would urge you to do so today. If there's anyone here that wants to do that, you come see me after we close the message and I'll talk to you about it. That's who Jesus is. That's who he reveals himself to John in this book of Revelation. Let's pray and then we'll sing hymn number 270, Having to Rest. Father in heaven, Lord God, we thank you for your word. We thank you what it teaches us. We thank you that we can know assuredly that Jesus is Jehovah. We thank you that you revealed yourself to us through the person of your Son. We thank you, Lord God, for these many great, wonderful blessings, especially for the great salvation we have in Jesus. The Lord our righteousness, who became sin for us that we might be made the righteousness of God in him. Praise the Lord. Thank you, Lord, for your wonderful gospel. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.